Hi, welcome to Your Capital What's Up. I'm Chuck Wiger, your area state senator. Thank you very much for watching. Today we're going to learn more about a very important subject, and that's perfluorochemicals, PFCs, and the impact that it has on our environment, and specifically some of the work that's been done for biomonitoring, some of the chemicals that had been disposed, and what's been the impact potentially on people in our community. We've addressed this legislatively, and we're going to hear from the Department of Health. The representative is representing them is Jessica Nelson. She's an epidemiologist and a program coordinator there. Welcome to our show, Jessica.
Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity.
Well, I'll just give some brief background, and then we'll talk more about what's being done. But back in the late 40s, in the 50s or so, there was quite a bit of chemical dumping that had gone on different parts of East Metro, as well as other areas of our country. But in my own district, some sites very well known in Oakdale. And concern then, over the years, were being raised in the 80s, 90s, et cetera. And then more recently, during some of the past legislative sessions, we've talked in response to people saying these chemicals that were dumped over 50, 60 years ago, is it having an impact on my health? Mm-hmm. And when those questions were being raised and in hearings, we had said, well, let's look more into this. Appropriations, money has been appropriated to mm-hmm. to study, to monitor, what went into the soil, what is the impact on the public, mm-hmm. and then we go to the experts like yourself to provide more information to citizens that have questions about that, to persons that have raised a lot of concerns about their own health. So with that background, Jessica, if you could tell us a little bit more about the issue, sure. and then we'll get into what's being done.
So yep.
Thank you.
Well, thank you for the introduction. That's right. So waste that contain PFCs were placed at different sites in the East Metro.
And Jessica, if you could tell us PFCs again, what are they? And
yep. So PFCs are perfluorochemicals, and they're a larger class of chemicals that are used pretty widely to make products stain-resistant, water-resistant, oil-resistant. So they're in things like carpeting, furniture, some fast food packaging contains them as well. So they're used widely.
It's very widely used.
Yeah, and we know that everyone is exposed to yes. some levels of PFCs. Studies test sort of average background Americans' blood, and we do find PFCs in almost everyone tested. Mm-hmm. There's a bunch of these chemicals, as I said, and some of them are very persistent in the environment and in people's bodies. So it takes a number of years for them to break down, and that's partly why we're concerned is that they stick around for a long time.
Okay.
So more of the background about the East Metro was that it was discovered that PFCs had seeped from the waste sites into the groundwater and was actually contaminating.
Yes. And these were sites that were approved.
They were approved, right.
It wasn't
legal.
In the dark of night.
No.
These were approved sites.
Disposal sites right. for wastes from the industry that
yes.
were put in landfills and other sites on the property of the company. But the chemicals did seep into the groundwater, and then it was discovered that they were contaminating some drinking water sources in the area.
Okay.
So in 2006...
So once contamination, drinking water, huge red flag,
yep.
alarm.
And then in 2006, and some in 2005, many measures were put into place to reduce PFCs in the drinking water. So the Oakdale City Water got large carbon filtration units installed.
Yes.
A lot of people on private wells were switched to city water or were given household carbon filter systems. And all drinking water levels are now below the limits that MDH considers unsafe. So they're all within safe limits set by MDH.
Okay.
So we know that remediation has been done.
Yes.
Where we come in, so I am working with the East Metro PFC3 Biomonitoring Project. We also call
say
it
the name of that again.
Okay. So it's the East Metro PFC3 Biomonitoring Project.
Yes.
We're also calling it just the PFC3 Project.
Okay.
And what we're doing is we're really trying to check to be sure that the measures that were put into place to reduce PFCs in drinking water are working to reduce PFCs in people's bodies.
Yes.
So I can tell you, let me tell you a little bit more about the specifics of that project.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the project is really trying to answer two main questions. The first question is whether PFC levels in longer-term East Metro residents, this is people from Oakdale, Cottage Grove, and Lake Elmo, whether those levels are continuing to decline. So we did two past biomonitoring projects and found that levels in a group of people declined substantially between 2008 and 2010, and we want to know if that's continuing. So we're going back in 2014 to check again in those people. So that's the first question. In this longer-term residence, are levels continuing to go down? The second question is, in newer Oakdale residents, are PFC levels similar to more U.S. background levels? And do they differ by the amount of time someone has lived in Oakdale? Mm-hmm. So those are the two things we're trying to answer with this project.
And you've sent letters out. There's been a great deal of awareness. It's voluntary. Someone does not have to submit to it, but there's blood tests, et cetera. Tell us about, you know, if you're a citizen and wondering, or maybe not directly affected, but wondering, you know, how do you participate and what happens next?
Okay. So yeah, about 2 weeks ago, we mailed letters to randomly selected households in Oakdale. The letters, I brought these just to show. So the letters sort of came in a white MDH envelope, and they did contain kind of this more colorful flyer.
Yeah, maybe we'll try to pick that up on the camera.
So yeah, so these letters went out a couple weeks ago, and basically how it works is that this letter asks folks for more information about adults in the household who might be eligible. Mm-hmm. We'll get those back. From that list of eligible adults, we'll then randomly pick up to 200 people to actually invite in.
Yeah.
And when someone agrees, what they'll be asked to do is to fill out a short questionnaire about possible exposure sources, and then go to Healthy's Oakdale, so a clinic in the community, to have a pretty small amount of blood drawn.
Okay.
And then if folks choose...
At Healthy's.
At Healthy's Oakdale,
yes.
Then if folks choose, they'll be able to receive their PFC test results from MDH. Our own public health laboratory does the blood tests, so they'll be able to receive the results for free. And all information will be kept private according to Minnesota law.
And everything is free.
Yes. And actually, we volunteers also will be compensated for their time because they do have to go to the clinic.
Yes.
And, you know, talk with us about some of the answers to those questions.
Okay.
So results are coming in. We really appreciate folks who have taken the time to fill out the form and send it back in. But we do need more responses. You know, we're hoping that people will take the time and read the materials and consider participating. One thing I did want to stress is that because of the way we've designed the study, each person's response is actually really important to the quality of the study.
Mm-hmm.
So we're hoping folks will think about the issue, take the time to look at the materials, call us if there are any questions, and then consider participating in the project.
Great. And then when will you have a report on the results?
So it takes some time to do the laboratory analysis of the blood samples. I think we're hoping that individuals can get their results probably like fall of 2014, and then we'll have a community result probably the following spring. So maybe about a year from now. We'll have some results. Are the levels continuing to go down? What's happening in the newer Oakdale residents, the new group that we're trying to recruit here?
Mm-hmm. And in other communities, you mentioned Lake Elmo, Cottage Grove, similar activities?
Well, we do have some folks from Lake Elmo and Cottage Grove in that original group who were following over time.
Okay.
We did choose to focus our new residents on Oakdale. And the reason for that really was that we wanted to answer the question of if those interventions have helped to reduce exposures in people.
Mm-hmm.
And there wasn't a similar intervention in Cottage Grove or Lake Elmo. It's more complicated with private well users because different things were happening at different times. And in Oakdale, there was a date, October 30th, 2006, when the filtration changed. So the new Oakdale residents that we're trying to get into our project are people who moved in after that happened and you know, who didn't drink water that we knew was contaminated. So,
any follow-up for those prior for those residents in terms of tests, or they may have moved, or?
Well, for everyone that we're able to contact, we are asking them to give a third blood sample. So we'll have 2008, 2010, and 2014. Okay. We had a really good participation rate on our second project in 2010. We were really happy with people's participation. So we're hoping that again in 2014, folks will want to participate again and sort of see their PFC blood level 6 years later.
So. Just summarizing results that you've had from the various monitoring. If you could highlight that again from the first phase and to where we're going. But what would the trends indicate?
So the first project showed that that these longer-term residents in the East Metro, so from Oakdale, Lake Elmo, and Cottage Grove, that those people did have PFCs in their blood and that the levels were elevated compared to U.S. background levels. The second phase showed that in the 2 years that went by between the two, that levels had decreased substantially, anywhere from 13% to 26%, depending on the PFC. That was
for those persons. I mean, for others.
In those same people. So we went back to the same people. And we measured the same PFCs a second time. So the PFCs had this nice substantial decline in that time.
Is this on average or for everyone?
It's on average.
Okay. So what if what if it's still elevated? In terms of treatment and?
Well, that is a good question. In fact, there were some people in 2010 whose levels hadn't gone down like most individuals had. What we made
of, you know, the good news is that it's going down,
but
if
that
it's
wasn't
not
the
you,
case for you,
then what?
Well, what it looked like at that time, and we found this when we've looked into it a little bit more, is that folks whose levels didn't go down tended to have the lower levels at the start of the project. Mm-hmm. So it looks like they were people who weren't drinking as much contaminated water or whose water wasn't as contaminated. So their exposure wasn't dominated by that water. It was more these other background exposures that we're talking about. So they didn't see the same decline. But we'll be very interested to see in 2014, do we see that again? Are more people's levels? It wasn't that many people in 2010, but there was a small group who didn't see that decline. And then as far as treatment goes, we really can't say for sure right now what a particular level of PFC means for health, for human health. It's a very active area of research. A lot of scientists are studying this. So there's no clinical treatment. That is, you know, kind of a more complicated factor about these blood tests. It's not like a cholesterol test or something like that. There's no clinical treatment at this time. But what we're doing is trying to sort of track the exposure trends over time, be sure that they're going down, and this check on new residents is sort of an additional way to ask this question. Okay. Did those measures to get the PFCs out of drinking water work?
Are there any other areas of the state? We've focused Oakdale, and appreciate that, and East Metro.
Yep.
Other areas of the state, and recognizing the ubiquity of PFCs internationally, but where you can get information from your colleagues on biomonitoring?
You know, we don't have blood levels from other areas of the state. It's actually part of the goal of our larger program is to think about, is there a way to sort of expand this tracking of biomonitoring to other parts of the state and to other chemicals? We have good national biomonitoring data, though, so that's how we know sort of this background U.S. level of exposure. But in Minnesota, there's really not much other information available. I think there will be some information for a community in northern Minnesota in the future, but right now it's pretty much the East Metro. We know a lot more about water testing. It's not the area of MDH I work on. There's, you know, a bunch of other folks who just focus on testing water, testing, you know, being aware of what's going on with PFCs. And I know there was some work done on, because PFCs were used in firefighting foams for a long time, so looking at some sites around airports and other places that may have had those firefighting foam used. But that could be a whole other topic for a show if you're interested. We could.
Well, you're an epidemiologist and as a program manager. Tell us about the training that you had for that to bring you in this position now.
So I have a background in public health, and actually specifically in environmental health and environmental epidemiology. I got a master's in public health in Boston, and then I stayed there and did a PhD in environmental health with a focus on environmental epidemiology there. So I'm trained
very highly trained.
How we design the studies, how we talk about the studies, how we analyze the data, and then sort of how we interpret their results for the community and for other people who are interested in the topics.
Okay, and so. You were you raised in Minnesota, or are you?
I was raised in California.
California to Boston.
But my dad is from Rochester, so I've always had family and family connections to Minnesota. And I came to undergrad in Minnesota, and
which school?
Carleton College.
Okay.
Yep. Kind of lost my. It felt like home.
And you went to school in Boston. Which school was that?
Boston University School of Public Health.
Well, wonderful.
Yeah.
So highly talented.
Thank you.
And obviously very motivated to serve the public, going to the mm-hmm. Department of Health. How long have you been there?
About 3.5 years.
Okay.
Yep.
In terms of the program itself, mm-hmm. Where do you see it going?
Yeah, so the name of our program is Minnesota Biomonitoring Chemicals in People, and it's part of MDH. And so what we do is we measure levels of chemicals in Minnesotans and then how those levels differ between groups and also over time. Mm-hmm. And the point is to use this information to promote public health actions that will reduce these chemical exposures. So that's sort of where we're hoping to go in the future.
And on the department's website, there's probably information with
yes.
some highlights about that?
Yep. We actually have a shorter web link, so it's just health.state.mn.us/biomonitoring.
Well, that's very good.
I hope that's right. Let's see. Yes. health.state.mn.us/biomonitoring.
Okay. And if they go to that site, paint us a picture, they'll learn what?
Yeah, they'll learn more about what biomonitoring is, how it can be used to help public health, and they'll learn about this PFC project. So if folks have specific questions, there's a whole area of PFCs. And then also about some of the other projects we're working on. We're doing some planning right now for a project to measure levels of chemicals and if there are disparities among different groups, specifically around mercury and some other metals. So they'll learn about some of our other projects and kind of a larger vision we have for the future of tracking different chemicals in Minnesotans and looking for disparities over time.
A very, very important public health mission, and we appreciate your commitment, involvement, and if we want the eligible Oakdale residents to participate in the study if they wish.
Yes.
It's in their best interest.
Yep.
It helps the research community as well.
Yes.
Letters have been sent out, but if someone has a question,
yep.
Was there a phone number?
Yeah, I can. And I should say, too, we're going to do another mailing to the same household.
Okay.
So you should be get it. If you haven't returned your survey and you're not sure where to find it, we will be sending another mailing in the next couple weeks. And the contact, if you do have questions, is Christina Rosebush. She's my colleague at MDH. Her number is 651-201-5908. And that's on the website, too, I believe. So.
Okay. Well, Jessica Nelson, we're almost out of time, okay. but any concluding remarks you'd like to share with our viewers?
Thank you for your time. And I guess just emphasizing this point that each person's response really will help with the quality of the study and will help, you know, the community learn more about current PFC exposures and will give folks a chance to know their own PFC levels if they choose to do that. So we hope you'll take the time. Thanks.
Thank you, Jessica Nelson, epidemiologist program coordinator at the Department of Health. It's very important, and we encourage viewers to learn more about this subject. And if you know someone directly affected, it's clearly in their best interest to participate. If you have questions of me, I encourage you to call me. My cell phone is 651-770-0283. With Jessica Nelson at the Department of Health, I'm Chuck Wiger. Thank you very much for watching.